Time and experience has taught me that the last session of a conference, everyone has just about had all the word they can take and just about had all of the services. And so there's usually sort of a tiredness that sets in somewhere about 10 minutes into the last sermon, and people just get relaxed and fall asleep. So wow, sorry. All right, well, scratch my plan of taking it easy on you. And I really, really just planned on dealing a little bit with a few verses and sharing a little bit of what the experiences the Lord has done in our lives. And so you're so angry about that. We'll just wing it and see what happens. How about that? I do want to say this. Based upon the nature of our kingdom sermon last night, I've had a lot of people asking eschatology questions today, end time events questions. And so rather than do an afternoon on end time events, there's no way you can do that in a sermon anyway. You actually would end up causing more questions than you would answer. What I would encourage you to do is I just started a video blog on my website, paulwhiteministries.com, and also Paul White Ministries is our Facebook page name. So I put new material every day. That's not really the point of this little speech, but I am doing a 20 minutes per week video blog on finished work eschatology. And I started that 5 weeks ago. There are currently 5 20-minute blogs, and we take it very slow, take it very contextually, and work our way from Matthew 21. We deal a little bit in Matthew 21. We deal a little bit in Matthew 23. We deal with the end times verses of the epistles, such as the last days, end of the age, these last days, end of the world. And then we go verse by verse through the 24th chapter of Matthew, which I'm convinced that if you can unlock the 24th chapter of Matthew, the rest of the New Testament will just unfold out in front of you. And so if you are interested in that topic, I would highly recommend check that out. It is free. It is on our site. It is on our app. And you can keep up with us as we go down that road and in that journey, okay? That will keep us from having to try to answer the myriad of questions that surface. And we're trying to answer those in that series, all right? And the website will be a good source for you to keep track of where we're heading around the world, but also we got all kinds of free stuff. So if you want the gospel of grace, you're going to have more than you can handle on that website. All right. Are you ready for some word?
Yeah.
All right. I had a revelation a few months ago. It was a very important revelation for me. Everyone needs to have the revelation of God's love in their own unique and special way. Everyone can get up and tell you God loves you. We can read the verses, God loves you. We all know them. But it doesn't necessarily mean anything to you until it's real to you. And what makes it real to you, there's no way to define that in a book. It's the same way that you can't read a book to figure out how you know you're in love. You know, if you say, well, how do I know if this is the right person? There's no book you can go check out at the library that says, these are the 5 steps to know if this is the right person. Someone's probably written that book and probably even made a lot of money, and then everyone got mad when the book didn't work. It doesn't work that way. The same way that you can tell people God loves them, and they can hear it and believe it and know it, but there's really no formula for getting it. It just takes a revelation. And I've known God loves me for a long time. But a few months ago, and our family was in transition, just over a year ago, the Lord began to move our hearts from where we were in the middle of the U.S., began to move it to Southern California, and we didn't really have any prospects. Everything was easy. I was pastoring a church that was, by definition, a grace church. We were debt-free. Money wasn't a problem. I didn't sit and fight in my church board meetings, and we didn't have big, you know, fisticuffs over sermons and songs. I was working with my brother in ministry. He's my praise leader. I got my dad on staff, who I was raised in his ministry. Everything is ideal until it wasn't. And what I mean by that is until that moment comes in your heart where you say, something's just not right. And so we began to just what do you want us to do, Lord? And I don't want to go through the long story of it, but the Lord opened doors, and we ended up in May of this year moving to Southern California, and we left the church. We announced our resignation in the winter, and then we left in the spring. We moved away in the summer, and every month for a year, we would fly to the new spot in Southern California, and I would just do tests on God. You know, I'm not a real big proponent of testing God, but how many of you know He can pass?
Yeah.
Whether it's biblical to do it or not, He's still really good at it. And I would, you know, we'd go out and say, well, Lord, you know, if we come out here, we gotta share the gospel, but I don't feel like you're telling us to start a church. So we're just gonna throw a meeting. We're gonna have it in the worst place. We're gonna have it in just this, the first one we had was in a gymnasium. It was on a basketball court. And we said, we're gonna have it in this gymnasium and just see what you do. And all of these people show up that had watched us and listened to us over the years and said, we're so glad you'd come to Southern California. And every month, God would do something weird like that. He would just do one of those moments where you knew. So I'm driving through the community one day in one of the monthly trips we made out there, and I was just so ecstatic about what God was doing. I couldn't figure out why He was doing it or what it was going to look like when He was finished, but I was so pumped. And I just remember getting this kind of this giddiness come over me in the car. I was all by myself driving, this giddiness come over me, and I, as clear as a bell, heard the Holy Spirit say, "Son, I like you." And I stopped. I remember it distinctly. I'll never forget that moment. I'm holding on to the steering wheel, and I had that moment where I just everything kind of froze in my life. I hadn't even been asking the Lord that. I hadn't been asking for a revelation, understanding His love deeper. But I knew it was Him because it wouldn't have just came out of nowhere. And I felt Him repeated in my spirit, "Son, I like you." And as the day went on, all I thought about was that He likes me. And as we actually was speaking that evening, and I got up in front of the group and began to speak, and the Holy Spirit began to minister in my heart that we live in a culture where love is kind of cheap. You know, everybody throws around, "Hey, I love you, bro," or love is like, "We love you and your family," but we're also a Facebook social media culture, and we get so hurt and offended if we post a picture of our kid's birthday party and not enough likes happen. You know what I mean? Not enough people like it. And then we look at our friends list and go, "What's wrong with Alan? Why would he look at my birthday picture and not click like?" You know, maybe we're not as good of friends as I thought we were. In kind of a like culture, and the Holy Spirit began to minister that in my heart, that in today's society, I'm praying for a revelation of God's like, yeah, in people's lives. And what I mean by that is, in a society where love seems cheap, but like is everything, if that's what it takes for God to get through to somebody, if you could leave this weekend and say, "You know, I knew when I got there God loved me, but when I left I had learned He actually likes me." Because the reality is, we love a lot of people because we have to. Christians do it all the time. So we go, "Well, you got to love everybody." I was taught that as a kid. "You got to love everybody if you want to go to heaven." Well, I wanted to go to heaven more than anything. So I would love you even if you weren't worth loving. But then there was always that thing on the side to go, "But you don't have to like them." And that was kind of the way we lived. Right? I might love you, but I don't want to hang out with you. And you know what? We're really still that way. I mean, I love you, but I don't necessarily like you. Well, to be loved by God is a great and beautiful thing. But I got to tell you, man, to be liked by God, I think, is even better. Because I know God loves everybody, but to know that He likes you. And I'm just here to tell you, He's very fond of you, man. He likes you. He is. He likes you. He likes everything about you. He made you that way. He likes hanging out with you. He likes hearing your voice. He likes being in the same room with you. God doesn't just love you enough that He would die on the cross for you. He likes you enough that He lives in your house. He likes you enough that He rides to work with you in your car.
Yeah.
So you got to like people to hang out with them. Love them, you can love them and hug them and let them go. But to like them, to be at their house and to eat a meal with them, you got to like them a little bit. And aren't you glad He likes you? That was the little revelation I wanted to share with you. It honestly really has very little to do with the scripture that I want to talk to you about this morning, but I just want you to know the fondness that the Father has for you. And let me tell you, it has been so finished on your behalf, that you should never, ever, ever feel as if you have to earn the goodness and the liking and the loving of God. In fact, never forget that if you try to go about earning the love of God or the favor of God or the blessings of God, you really prostitute what Jesus did on the cross. And God would never prostitute what his son paid for at Calvary by giving you blessings based upon your performance. He would have to apologize to Jesus, who was supposed to be paying for all of your blessings through his finished work. And it is so good for me to know, and I want to pass on to you, that God is so in love and so in like with you that nothing that you do will ever be so offensive that God would turn away from you. And a lot of us were raised in a church culture where we believed that God could get offended and turn away from us. This is silly. I'm going to just admit this is beyond silly. This is stupid. I actually believed for a lot of my life, growing up and then into adulthood and then into ministry, I actually believed that there were places and events that you could go to and be a part of that the Holy Spirit would literally walk outside of you and wait on you to come out. That you had the Holy Spirit, that the Lord loved you and he lived inside of you, but there were certain activities that a Christian should not be involved in, and that if you went to that activity, the Holy Spirit would walk outside of you and wait at the front door. That's a sad commentary on how I understood the Holy Spirit, but it's also sad on our understanding of the separation of God. James said, all good and perfect gifts come from the Father above, the Father of lights, in whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That means God never turns. You and him are always on speaking terms, and God never turns away from you. So don't ever fear you can do something so bad that God will turn away. And if you took nothing else this weekend, take that from this preacher, that you can never cause God to turn away from you. Man, I think that is good news. Go with me to the book of James. I want to share with you some things the Holy Spirit has, over the course of this weekend, put on my heart. This is not a message that I came with any intentions at all of sharing. But as the weekend unfurled and we began to see what was preached and taught, and really this today for me came out of questions. It came out of walking around at camp and talking to people and having more than one person say this and more than one person say that and start to get a feel of what we could close with, how we could kind of tie a ribbon on this weekend. And that has to do a lot with, and Peter talked about it a little bit this morning that we were going to do this, the idea of confession of sins. I know 1 John 1:9 was brought up this week, and that's always a hot button topic in Scripture, and I want to throw my own hat into the ring on that and give what I believe is what the Lord has shown me, but more importantly, to give you an understanding of a passage of Scripture that for a long time has been a little bit, I think, misunderstood. James chapter 5, I just did a verse-by-verse study on the book of James, and it was one of the great adventures of my life because I was always a little bit worried about the book of James. There's a lot of things in there that I didn't quite understand through the lens of grace, but I've learned to embrace this book, and part of the embracing of the book of James is to understand a couple of key components. I don't want to bore you with history. I'll move quickly. Number one, James probably wrote his epistle before everybody else wrote their epistles or their gospels. So James is probably the first thing penned in what we call the New Testament. And the second thing that's very important to note is, since that be the case, you can put James in the very early chapters of the book of Acts, in the developmental period of the early church, way before Paul has a revelation of God's grace, and way before the church has even come to the conclusion on how they're going to deal with Gentiles getting saved. By Acts 15, they still can't even figure out if Gentiles should keep the Mosaic law. And now for us, that's not even a conflict. But half of the book of Acts is actually comprised of men who believe that Gentiles should be keeping the law in order to really be saved. And James was sort of the ringleader of that. Please understand that James, along with, and this is a shocker for a lot of us, James, along with all the other writers in the Bible, did not write to you. None of the books of the Bible were written to you. However, they were all written for you. So James writes to 12 tribes scattered. He's not writing to you and to me. He's writing to his Jewish brethren who've come to know the Lord. And his book is very little about grace and very little about Jesus. He mentions Jesus twice, and he only mentions grace in one verse. He's not a book that really deals with the grace of God, that really deals with the favor of God. He does write from the early perspective of mixing and mingling some of those works with that faith. But it doesn't mean we should discount the book. It means we should read it through that lens and then realize some very important and powerful things about this writing. I want to start with verse 13 of James chapter 5. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. He prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Now, it looks like James is all over the map. I mean, he talks about laying on of hands and anointing with oil, calling the elders forward. He talks about if you're happy, sing. He talks about if you sin, you have forgiveness, but you need to confess that to each other so you can be healed. And then he goes off into a tangent on Elijah and how Elijah was a good prayer warrior. But I think James has a certain flow to him that has been lost, to pardon for a better expression, it's been lost in translation. Because we added verses and chapters and we busted up and put a verse here and a verse there in a way that oftentimes kind of warps the way we read, because we read in chapters and verses. And sometimes we stop right where we should have kept going because the verse is at the end of the verse or the chapter is at the end of the chapter. And if we had kept going, we would have seen something beautiful. But when we work our way through this passage, we find some pretty fascinating stuff about James. The first thing is about the anointing with oil. You're sick, you call on the elders of the church. How many of you are in churches or were raised in churches in a church culture where anointing with oil was a part, sort of part and parcel of the weekly service? Okay, a fourth, maybe fifth of the house. So was I. In fact, it was such a part of the service that it became literally the predictability of going to church on Sunday. Here's what they're going to do, and then here's what they're going to do, and then here's what they're going to do. One of those points was they're going to call people up and anoint them with oil. And if you're totally unfamiliar with that practice, what it looked like in our church culture was we kept little bottles of olive oil on the platform, and now churches did it different ways. Some churches, they just poured it all over your head, and there was towels everywhere, and we were a little more professional with our oil sprinkling. We use water guns. No, that was always what I dreamed of as a kid. I was like, wouldn't that be cool if they just used a super soaker? Because I was a kid thinking we could move a lot faster. They would just hit everybody with the oil one time. We would take the vial and we'd, you know, you'd flip the vial, you get a little bit on your finger, and you'd smear it on their head, and then you'd pray as loud as you could. I threw that little last part in there just as a bonus because that was the way we did it. You put it on there and then everyone screamed as loud as they could. And then when you wore out, you said amen and then they went and sat down. Whether they were healed or not. But I'm not in any way making fun of the practice of anointing with oil at all. In fact, James was so serious about this because the Jews believed there was power to be found in the oil because it was a symbolism of the Holy Spirit and it was a symbolism of the anointing. And what greater to call upon than the power of the Holy Spirit when you were in need? And so they used that symbol and they would anoint with oil, but we did it in a way that kept the service flowing. Everybody come forward to be anointed with oil. But James said, if you're sick, call the elders to you. And so James was actually saying, if it's so bad you can't get to the community meeting, call the elders and the elders will come to your house. And when they get there, they'll bring a representative of what they have in the circle, in the group. Because what do we have in the group? We have the power of the Holy Spirit that is found in a very amazing way in community. You see, you have the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. But when you come together as a community, there is a manifestation of the power of the Holy Spirit that is special. It's why you do feel something when you get together with God's people. Have you ever thought about why is it you feel this? Well, it's just emotion. We're just excited. That's part of it. But there is a tangible thing that happens when God's people come together in the power of community. And when that's cut off from your life, a lot of really odd and terrible things can begin to transpire. People find themselves an island and alone, and depression can set in, and they feel cut off from the body. And I know we're going, well, I still have Jesus in me. That's all I need. But we've all been made for community, because it's not Christ the head over you, the body. It's Christ the head over you and me, the body. All of us as the corporate body of Christ. In fact, Jesus once goes to the Gadarenes. Remember the Gadarene demoniac? The kid that comes out cutting himself and foaming at the mouth, literally. And everyone's scared of the Gadarene demoniac. He's been sleeping in the local graveyard. I mean, the kid is off the rails and he's so possessed with devils that no one can even deal with him. And he runs to Jesus. And you know the story. Jesus casts out legion. There's 1,000 demons in this guy, or more. Thousands of demons in this guy. He casts legion out. And the young man is then, the Bible says, he's sitting and clothed and in his right mind. And none of those things were characteristics of him an hour ago before he was delivered. And now here he is sitting at the feet of Jesus and he's sane. And Jesus says to his disciples, let's get on the boat and go. And the young man says, I want to go with you. And Jesus turns him down and says, no, you're not going with me, because you need to go back to your family and you need to tell people what has happened in your life. And the Lord, I was reading that a few years ago, and the Holy Spirit began to speak to me and said, what happened in this young man's life is he cut himself off from his family. He isolated himself from community. And the next thing you know, he was in bondage. And so teach the church to go back into their community, go back into that unit where they find life. And so Jesus refused to take the young man with him because he had a mission, which was you need to go get plugged back in to the place where you are. And so there is something powerful that happens in community. James is saying, if you're so sick you can't get to community, then call community and bring them to you. And so then they'll bring the oil and they'll anoint you with oil and they'll pray the prayer of faith and then you can be healed. And so I'm not mocking the laying on of hands with oil, but it became a ritual for us, not really the way James intended for it to be, which was you were so sick you couldn't get there. We'll come to you and be a representative of the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Now, keeping that in mind, what in mind? Community. James is concluding his book by bringing the 12 scattered tribes back together. James 1:1, James to the 12 tribes scattered abroad. And then his book is to bring them back together into a unity of thought. And so in bringing them back together in a unity of thought, he brings them back together into a unity of worship. And when James starts to think, how would I unify the church? One of those issues that are going to come up is going to be the confession of trespasses. Look at 15. The prayer of faith is going to save the sick. The Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Now, what happened a lot of times is we would put the two together and we would say, when you anoint them with oil, if they're healed, they're also forgiven automatically. Because the text says that you pray for them and then they're healed, and if they have any sins, they shall be forgiven. And I think it's just a translation error. It's a whole new sentence. It's a thought that stands by itself, which is, there is the power to see sins forgiven. It's the same power to see sicknesses healed, is the same power to see sins forgiven. And James is trying to let his church in on that. The power to see your sins forgiven. Now watch 16. How many of your Bibles? Verse 16 begins with confess. Is there anyone whose 16th verse does not begin with the word confess? What does yours say?
Therefore.
Therefore. What translation are you using?
NIV.
Therefore is actually found in the earliest Greek translations, but was dropped in subsequent translations. Now, what is powerful about the word therefore? Something happened before it. Yes. Or I always like to say, if there's a therefore, find out what it's there for. So we have to, if the earliest Greek manuscripts are correct, verse 16 should say, therefore confess your trespasses to one another. Therefore confess your trespasses. Why therefore? Based upon the previous sentence, you have information. The previous sentence is the end of 15. If you've committed sins, you will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. In light of the fact that Jesus provides forgiveness of sins, We should be in the business of confessing our trespasses to one another and praying for one another. Now, what in the world does me confessing to you have to do with him forgiving me of my sins? Our law minds will go back to where Jesus says, if you don't forgive your neighbor, you won't be forgiven. But we know under grace that there's something way more powerful than I unlock his power to forgive me by forgiving you. But rather, it all lies, and this is going to help us with 1 John 1:9. It all lies in the Greek definition of the word confess. It really comes down to understanding that what we're looking at is the English and not the Greek. The word confess that is used right there. Now, if you're a note taker, this is really, really going to help you down the road in your life to have a little bit of knowledge of what this word means in the Greek. All right? The word confess in the 16th verse is the Greek word eximologio. Eximologio. And logio, logos. Everybody knows logio, logos. Logos is word or spoken word. And since we're dealing with the word confess, that makes sense that word is going to be in there somewhere. Eximologio, though, means exactly what we would define the word confess in the English. Because if I were to say to you, what does it mean to confess? We'd say, own up to it. Admit it. Own it. That's a word we love to use now. Own it. Eximologio would be confess the word, say the word, admit the word. But here's a bonus. Admit or own it or confess it or say it joyfully. That's in the Greek. Say it joyfully. It's so joyful that the translators do not always translate eximologio the same way. Okay? Let me give you an example. In Matthew 11, Jesus makes this statement to his disciples. He says, actually, he's praying in front of his disciples. And he says, Father, I thank you that you have hidden the deep things from the wise and the prudent, but have revealed them unto the babies. He's talking about all of us. Father, I thank you. The word thank, eximologio. Father, they could have said, Father, I confess that you have hidden the deep things from the wise and prudent, but you've delivered them to the babies. But they don't translate it that way. They say thank you because there's joy coming up in his voice. Dad, I'm so excited that you didn't reveal this to the really smart ones, but you revealed it to all the rest of us. And so that's the same word that James uses in James 5 when he says, confess your sins to one another. Therefore, confess with joy to each other. Why? What was the last sentence of verse 15? If you committed sins, you will be forgiven. Therefore, confess with joy the stuff that has been a hindrance in you, because whatever it is that's in a hindrance to you has been forgiven in the previous verse. In other words, this isn't a depressing verse. It's a verse of excitement for believers to say, hey, let me tell you what Jesus has done for me. I really think verse 16 is the same as a testimony service. What do we do in a testimony service? Nobody ever has testimony services anymore? Okay, well, let me go back to my childhood. Testimony service was another thing we did, especially on Sunday night. Because we didn't do all the stuff on Sunday night that you did on Sunday morning. You had to have other stuff. You know, we didn't have choir on Sunday night, but we had to take up time. So what do? Testimony service. So you went and grabbed a mic and you said, who's going to lead our testimony service? Brother John, would you come up here and lead? And Brother John would get up and tell everything the Lord had done for him that week. And then they'd say, does anyone else have something they'd like to say for the Lord? Sometimes you passed the mic, sometimes you didn't. No one ever wanted to go up front because everyone was embarrassed. But some people like to stand, some people like to sit. And then we would spend a lot of time talking about what happened, and the devil would usually get a lot of praise, which was unfortunate. Well, we did, because people get up and go, you know, the devil's been beating me upside the head. Praise his holy name. I'd sit there as a kid and go, I think they meant for there to be a period there. Devil's been beating me upside the head, period. Praise his holy name. They meant to point. They just forgot to point. So the devil got glory. So what would we do in testimony services? Really just testifying about what God had done in us. And it went off the rails a lot. It did. But what it was really to do was for me, if I'm testifying, hopefully what we get out of it is I encourage you, because perhaps I say something that you go, oh, he dealt with that this week. Praise God, I'm not alone. What did that do in community? It caused you to say, oh, I don't have to be perfect because so-and-so is not perfect. Now, we kind of pick and choose in testimony service what we testify about. I mean, I was in this my whole life as a kid. And I bet I went to 75 testimony services a year because we didn't do them every, you did them every week and then you did sometimes two of them. I did 75 or 100 testimony services a year and I heard over and over confession of approvable sins. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Like somebody would get up and testify and go, you know, I've been having a problem with jealousy this week. Man, I know it's not right, but everybody pray for me. Everybody in the building go, praise God, amen, yes. We're going to believe for Brother Tom's jealousy issue. And then, you know, you're over on the other side of the building going, I knew it. Her sister Sue would stand up and say, you know, I've been having trouble with gossiping. We go, oh, praise God. Praise God. Jesus, help her. Deliver her from gossip. She'd go, I'm receiving deliverance. So those were provable sins. I never one time in all of my years had someone get up and say, I've been struggling with homosexuality. I'd like for you guys to pray with me. Never one time. There was unapprovable testimonial sins. And that's what weakened testimony service. Because it became about celebrating my victories while only bringing to the surface the stuff that you approve of. And we never got real with each other. And we really ignored James 5 that said, confess with joy to your neighbor the stuff, because no matter what the stuff, your sins are forgiven you. So learn to bring to your brother the issue that might bring joy and excitement in his life to know that, hey, I'm not alone, and our God is a big God. Amen. So while there was rarely someone that got up and said, I've really been tempted this week to commit adultery, and you go, well, that would have been horrible. That would have been like dropping a bomb in the middle of the church. Can you imagine how your church experience would have been different if there had been reality happening when people talked about their lives, their lifestyle, and their God? What runs people out of the church is a lack of reality. It's the final expose that there was a lot of fake going on and that you didn't really know the people that you thought you knew so well. And James, when he closes his book trying to bring unity to the people, decides that if we're going to be the real deal, we're going to have to be a bit more transparent, and we're going to have to tell our neighbor what's going on in our lives so that we may be healed. Look at the rest of 16. Confess those. Exomologio, profess joyfully your trespasses to one another, and then pray for one another so that you may be healed. I don't believe that we're just talking about sickness in this passage, because we've already talked about sickness in the previous passage. This is not healing of the flu or pneumonia or a backache. This is a healing of what those trespasses have done in my life. And if I could get you in on it, to where you and I together could begin to explore the beauty of the end of the 15th verse, that we truly are forgiven, I could finally find healing for what's going on in my life. But we haven't created that culture in the church. We've created the culture of cover it up and deal with it on your own through a system of works and performance. Maybe a little silent counseling. And I'm not about coming in and screaming out what's going on in your life. But if we don't begin to pull together with one another, we're not really a church. We're just a bunch of Christians. And every one of us believes that the church is really meeting today in a garage. They don't have to just meet in a church building. They're meeting right here, right now, because of who we are together. But until there's the transparency of we know we are forgiven, and thus the knowledge that we are forgiven helps us to deal with what's going on in our lives, I don't think we're going to get anywhere. And we're certainly not going to get anywhere in the Grace Church as long as we keep acting like sin isn't sin. Like we say, well, you know, now that you're under grace, that's not really sin, because there's really no sin. And I go, you can kick out most of the writings of the New Testament that very much believed that there was a way to live beyond it, to live in victory over, that you didn't have to live in the way that you had been living before. But it's not about obsessing about your sins and your failures. It's about confessing the forgiveness that comes to you in Christ and then joyfully receiving all of that forgiveness in your life. And in that moment, in that beautiful thing, I think we're going to see something that we've been longing to see in the church. A reality that is unachievable in any other way. Now, exomologio is to confess it. It's to say it. But that's not what John uses in 1 John. In 1 John 1:9, which has become the verse of how do we deal with those who maybe don't believe grace or don't believe what we would refer to as radical grace or pure grace. And they say, well, 1 John 1:9 says, confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So don't you believe that you should always be in the confessing your sins mode? I believe according to James 5, it's very clear. Exomologio, you should profess with joy whatever it is in your life because of the knowledge that Jesus Christ has forgiven you. And you should do that to each other all the time because you're never going to find a way to strengthen someone any more than the day you admit you're not perfect. And man, will that strengthen your neighbor. That'll make a big, big difference in your neighbor. It's a guarantee. That's what is great about preaching with transparency versus preaching to perform. You preach to perform, you got to make people think you don't have any problems. You preach with transparency, you just let people see what they are. Right. People can either be turned to that or turned away from that. And you can live that way too. You can live with transparency, you can live to try to put up a front, put up a face. So go to 1 John. Well, you don't even have to go to 1 John 1:9. Probably everybody in this room knows, confess your sins, he's faithful and just forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But if you like taking notes and you want James 5 to help you with 1 John 1:9, then go there and in the margins you can write down what confess means in the Greek. It's not exomologio. It's homologio. And homo is the prefix same as. Same as. Logio, logos, word. Homologios. Now, logios or logios is to proclaim the word. Homo then, same as, say the same thing as, is homologio. It's not what James says. James does not tell you to say the same thing as your neighbor about your sin. That doesn't make any sense. Because sometimes your neighbor is going to say some bad things about your sin. So if you were saying the same thing as your neighbor said about your sin, you don't know what rock you're standing on. It could be shifting sand. It will actually vary from person to person. But if you know what God says about your sin, then you should say the same thing God says about your sin. Confess your sin. He is faithful and just to forgive you of that sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So when, and Peter said this so well. I'm so glad he brought out nouns and verbs. Because there's a noun. Confess your sin. It's not confess the actions you've been doing. It's confess who you are. And who are you? And so when you first come to Christ, you come to Christ as a sinner,
that's right.
An unbeliever, lost. You do not know the Lord, and thus you are led by the nature to sin. If you will confess that, He is faithful and just to cleanse you of that, forgive you of that, and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But you say, well, I want to keep doing that, Pastor. I want to keep going back and confessing my sin. Then you should do it according to what John said, do. Say the same thing as. So now when you go back to God and confess, you better confess the same thing God says about you. Before you came to Jesus, what He would say about you is, you're a sinner, and you're lost, and you're in need. But now that you are a saint, what should you say about you? Perhaps you should say that. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Perhaps you should say, he that was without sin became sin, so that I could be made the righteousness of God in Christ. Maybe you should say, I am your righteousness.
Yes.
You know what really helped me on this verse? I mean, really helped me. I was dealing with a young man, he's a little bit older than me. He and I came up in ministry together. We didn't live in the same state. He was a couple states over from me. And we came up in ministry and we're cross paths over and over. He would be at a church, I would be at a church. He was at my father's church a time or two, and I actually preached in his father's church and then his church. But we were mixture guys, Pentecostal background, come up together, would exchange sermon notes and all of those things. And I the Lord began to really deal with me about grace, and it just transformed my life. And I lost him, you know. We would talk, but we weren't talking the same anymore. And we were kind of drifting, and you could tell we weren't really on the same page. And then we'd go a year and not talk at all. And then finally, just, oh, you remember that guy? That kind of thing. Anybody have those?
Yeah.
I've still got a lot of those. Yeah. And I hope their story ends the way this one is ending. Yeah. And finally, this young man began to call me and say, man, I'm seeing some stuff in the Word. And it was the baby steps of grace. And so we would just walk along and talk along about these things. And we were talking about the nature and the being crucified in Christ and being raised up. And it was just being slowly baby stepping him into the acknowledgement of his righteousness. And I kept being stunned that we weren't hitting the verse. What's the verse? 1 John 1:9. I was stunned. Every time we would talk, we wouldn't hit the verse. I just kept waiting on him to ask, because we came up preaching together, you know, and I thought he's gonna need help with that one, and I'm gonna be Superman. I'm gonna give him all the help he needs. And nothing. And we're getting to be years into the journey. And he's becoming a grace guy, and he's got a missions group, goes overseas and preaches the grace of God. And I just couldn't take it anymore. So I brought it up. And I said, hey man, I casually snuck it into conversation, Joe Cool. And I said, 1 John 1:9, he says that's a good example. And so I'm going on and on about it. I noticed he's real quiet. And I said, what do you think about that? And he said, I'll be honest with you. He said, that was the verse that when I was a mixture guy scared me the most in the whole New Testament. And I said, why did it scare you as a mixture guy? And he said, because the Greek for cleanse is progressive. He said, confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to keep on cleansing you of all your unrighteousness. He said, I learned that a long time ago in Bible college, that it was to keep on cleansing you from all unrighteousness. So that verse scared me, because as a guy that believed you could lose your salvation, I just always hoped no one would ever ask me about 1 John 1:9. Because if 1 John 1:9 is correct, once you confess your sin, the waterfall of cleansing starts, and according to the Greek syntax, never stops. He said, I was always worried someone would ask me, why should I keep confessing if the waterfall keeps on flowing? And it hit me. This is why he hasn't asked me about it in 2 years. Because he thought I had it figured out. Let me tell you what. According to John, the moment that you own up to who you are and say the same thing about you that God says about you, which when you come to Jesus is, I need to come to Jesus. And God's saying the same thing. The moment you say that, he begins to cleanse you of unrighteousness and never turns off the spout. Cleanse, 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 cleanse. Even when you fail, now when you confess, say what God says about you. This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased. His sins and his iniquities will I remember no more. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And over and over and over, the cleansing, cleansing, cleansing of my unrighteousness due to his righteousness, and I can't make it stop. Isn't that good news?
Amen.
That excites me. So listen, if you want to confess all of your sins to the Lord every time you commit them, I'm not going to stop you. The reality is that the flow of righteousness has not stopped even when you sinned. It just kept flowing and flowing and flowing. I have a lot of people say to me, but don't you think it's good for my own conscience just to confess that I'm a sinner? And I say, you no longer can trust your evil conscience now that you have the Holy Spirit in your life, because the Holy Spirit is above and beyond the evil conscience. In fact, the book of Hebrews tells us that we go out as believers and commit dead works because of our evil conscience. Do you know what our evil conscience means? It means that we'll do something wrong and our evil conscience will tell us that we're a sinner and that we're going to lose our salvation. And so the enemy will quickly recommend three or four dead works for you to perform in order to feel good about your salvation. Right. How many of you realize that the enemy is good at recommending three or four good dead works? And they're the good fruit on the wrong tree. Right. And the enemy will say, if you'll do three or four of those, you'll feel better. And God will be accepting of who you are. It was never the Holy Spirit telling you to go do three or four dead works to achieve a good conscience. You don't live by your conscience. You live by the sound of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And the sound of the Holy Spirit mirrors who He is and what He is in our lives. Look at the end. Confess your trespasses to one another. Pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer. We're still dealing with prayer. The effective, I think King James says effectual. Mm-hmm. Effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And then we get into Elijah. I guess this is fitting because we spent last night with Elijah and Elisha. And so our minds are still fresh on the spirit of Elijah. And James calls Elijah to mind. And Elijah for a Jew was the apex of a prayer warrior. I mean, if Moses is the law keeper, Elijah's the prayer warrior. Nobody could pray quite like Elijah. And so James, when he picks a warrior of prayer, chooses Elijah. But he does something interesting. He tells you that the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And then when he tells you how Elijah prays in the middle of 17, he doesn't use the phrase effectual, fervent prayer of Elijah. He uses the earnest prayer of Elijah. Because James is wanting to show you the difference in your prayer and Elijah's prayer. You see, Elijah couldn't be called the righteous man. Elijah had never been washed in the blood of Jesus. Christ had never shed blood to pay while Elijah was alive for Elijah's sin. So Elijah was bound by the Mosaic law. For him, his prayer could be nothing more than earnest. But for you, the righteous man, you have an effectual or effective fervent prayer. Effective and fervent are the same thing in the Greek. They're actually one Greek word. Effective, fervent prayer. I think Peter used it today. Energy. Energio in the Greek. It means work or ability. It's the same word as effectual, fervent. So God is saying to you, you're the righteous man. How many of you are the righteous man? You'd be a little quicker with that hand if you believe it, man. Well, maybe you don't know. Maybe we don't know if we're the righteous man. Righteousness comes not by works of the law. Righteousness is going to come by faith in Jesus Christ. He's going to declare us just and justified, declare us righteous based upon our faith in what Jesus has done for us. Jesus was made sin so that we could be made righteous. We place our faith in that. We become the righteous man. Now, how many of you are the righteous man?
Amen.
You, when you pray, the effective, the energy of the righteous man avails much. Energy towards what thing? Prayer. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Your prayer works. Because you're the righteous man. And just to show you how well it works, he compared you to Elijah. He said the effective fervent prayer of the righteous man avails much. How much? Like Elijah, except Elijah had to pray earnestly. Elijah ended up doing a lot of screaming and yelling. Your prayer works.
Amen.
It's good news.
Amen.
Just in case you didn't realize, it's good news. Your prayer works. You're the righteous man. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain. It did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. He prayed again. The heaven gave rain. The earth produced its fruit. There's just one more little thing I want to bring out in this. And I'm going to close. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. In other words, what James is trying to say, and Paul would say it better, and I want to elaborate on that before I end. What James is trying to say is that Elijah was a man, he wasn't a superman, and yet he saw all kinds of stuff happen that you would say was a superman. But I say to you that you're the righteous man. You don't have to be the superman, you're the righteous man. And when you pray, your prayer works, even though you have the same problems Elijah had. Now, Paul would have said it better because Paul doesn't refer to you inside of your old nature. Paul believes that your old nature died with Christ. He got that as a revelation by seeing Jesus and hearing the new covenant. And so for Paul, your old nature died one time and your new man raises up in Christ. And so now Peter even grabbed it and said, you are partakers of the divine nature. And so you have it better than Elijah ever had it before. And if I could tag on from last night, you're not even in his age anymore. You're not even in his spirit anymore. For you, you're the righteous man, and it avails much. I had one other thing in my heart from last night that I wanted to say as I conclude. And I wanted to deal with this confession today. Seriously, wasn't going to go very long. I thought, well, I'll fall asleep and then I'll just quit. So we went a little bit longer than we thought. But I want you to know that the kingdom of God is not yours to advance. There's the idea sometimes when you start talking to people about the kingdom, they go, okay, now let's go out and build the kingdom. You are not a kingdom builder, okay? You are not, it is not your job. Jesus said the kingdom of God is like a man that takes a seed and drops it in the ground and then goes to bed. Literally. And when he wakes up the next day, he goes to work, and then that night he goes to bed, and then to work, and to bed. And you get the point. And he doesn't do anything, and the seed does the job. God's not looking for kingdom spreaders. God's just looking for people to plant the kingdom in someone else's life. And then leave it alone. You see, they may not move as fast as you want them to. How many of you know that some people aren't going to change as quickly as you want them to change? You're going to put the kingdom of God's grace and mercy inside of people's lives, and you're going to expect that they're going to register for Grace Camp in the first 12 hours of their kingdom theology. They're going to say, when's the next time we can all get together and talk about Jesus? And you might be surprised that it won't happen that way. In fact, a lot of them are going to talk the same way, dress the same way, act the same way, do all the same stuff they did before you dropped the seed of the kingdom in. But Jesus said, don't panic, because the kingdom of heaven is like a woman that takes 3 measures of meal, and she just drops a little pinch of leaven in. And when the leaven hits, what happens? The whole lump rises. He says she doesn't have to put leaven equal to the size of the lump, to the meal. She just puts a little bit. So we're not asking you to put the kingdom in great measure into someone's life. We're asking you to put a little bit of the kingdom into someone's life and watch the kingdom go to work. And the kingdom looks like the Holy Spirit. It sounds like the Holy Spirit. It's the gifts of the Spirit: love and joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, goodness, self-control. The 9 gifts of the Spirit, I don't know very many people that have all 9. I think my wife's really close. As far as I'm concerned, you really are. I don't know very many people that have all 9 gifts of the Spirit. And yet you're still part of the kingdom. How'd you pull that off? I mean, I know people that have, they're great with kindness, but they're not real good with self-control. Or they got joy in spades, but they don't have a lot of gentleness. They have peace, but they have a real problem with long-suffering. Or vice versa. They have long-suffering. Maybe they have a problem with peace, but I don't know. How are they still part of the kingdom? Because it's just a little bit, and then the tree goes to work. Now, how would you get some more fruit out of that believer? Well, they have love, joy, and peace down, but they're really struggling with long-suffering. And what you want to see in your church is the church of the long-suffering. And that's who we are here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to plow into that ground, and we're going to make that tree a long-suffering tree. Well, if you're as good at making trees produce as I am, you'll kill it. I'm not very good at making trees produce. I kill them very, very easily. So the Christianity is not about behavior modification. It's not about performance. It's about allowing people to be transformed into the image of God, and that doesn't always move quickly. And so I'll close with this. If you want, and I've said this all over the world, if you want people to act right, fast, preach the law. But if you want people to have a transformation, and it might take a long time, preach the righteousness by faith in the grace of God. If you just need a kid, sleep with Hagar, and you can have an Ishmael in 9 months. But if you want God's kid, 14 years later, you get an Isaac. So for those of you who leave and say, oh, we're going to go back and transform our church, hold on for the long ride. Because the reality is the kingdom is not something that explodes on the scene. Jesus said it doesn't come by observation. Some people keep waiting on Jesus to just pop, there's the kingdom. Jesus said you're in it, but don't expect trees to grow overnight. Give it time. Let the Holy Spirit nurture it. Let it come out in people. So when you see love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kind, praise God for what you see. Don't shake the tree to get what you don't see. Receive people for who they are. Confess with joy the lack and the deficiency that you have because you realize you have received forgiveness of sins. And then believe that you are the righteous man. And if you pray it, heaven moves. Because you're part of the kingdom. And you have a king. Aren't you glad for that? Yes. Praise God. Hey, give God some glory, man. What a way. What a way to end. What a way to end. Father, I want to thank you for this meeting and this gathering. I want to thank you for... It was a little bit different kind of lesson that you put in our heart today. It was a little bit different style, and I love that because I don't like predictability. I don't think the Holy Spirit does the same thing twice. I think you just like to move the river to the left one day so everyone maybe that didn't get it the day before gets it. I don't know why you do it the way you do it. I'm just glad to be there for the ride. I want to thank you for the Word, though. The Word works. Man, the Word is real, even if it builds differently and the puzzle pieces come together in a different fashion than they did the sermon before. Man, the Word works. What a powerful Word. Thank you, Father. Thank you. That there is a joyful confession we can have about our failures to our neighbor that in the presence of community actually strengthens our neighbor. What an awesome thing. And that there's also the ability to confess what you say about us. And when we do, we realize that there's a waterfall of forgiveness that flows every moment of every day in our lives. I thank you, Father. I thank you. There's some Isaacs being birthed in this house, but they're a long way from maturity. And every one of us have an Ishmael or two running around in our lives that we've tried to produce by our own efforts. And we're still dealing with those little rascals. And Father, I'm believing that in this hour, you're going to teach us something about the kingdom that brings out in us the reality of the King. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
God bless you. We love you. Thank you.